Welcome to the 26th lecture in this lecture series introducing international investment law. In the last two lectures, we discussed the umbrella clause. In the last lecture, that is the 25th lecture, we discussed the SGS versus Pakistan case where the tribunal took a restricted view of the umbrella clause and held that the clause could not be construed to have included even contractual claims. Those who have not yet watched the last lecture may do so. Link to the lecture is provided in the description to this video. In this lecture, we discuss various other approaches to the umbrella clause. As a prelude to the discussion, it could be said that the umbrella clause has not received a uniform interpretation. Different tribunals, including the one in SGS versus Pakistan, have construed the clause differently. The approach in SGS versus Pakistan was heavily criticized by another tribunal involving the same claimant, that is SGS, in SGS versus Philippines, where the tribunal held, among other things, interpreting the actual text of Article 10, Subarticle 2, it would appear to say and to say clearly that each contracting party shall observe any legal obligation it has assumed or will in the future assume with regard to specific investments covered by the BIT. Article 10(2) was adopted within the framework of the BIT and has to be construed as intended to be effective within that framework. The SGS versus Philippines Tribunal considered that uncertainties in the BIT should be resolved in order to favor the protection of the covered investments. This was found in para 116. In El Paso versus Argentina, decision on jurisdiction dated 27th April 2006, and Pan American versus Argentina, which is also a 2006 decision. Here, the tribunal gave a different twist to the umbrella clause. Both awards were passed under the USA-Argentina BIT of 1991, in which the relevant clause was widely worded and provided each party shall observe any obligation it may have entered into with regard to investments. This was found in Article 2, Subarticle 2 and Clause C. Taking cue from SGS versus Pakistan, insofar as the arguments regarding flood of lawsuits and overreach because of a wider construction than other guarantees in the treaty, that both these tribunals made a distinction between host state as a merchant and that of a sovereign and concluded that the investment arbitration would cover only disputes where the host state was a sovereign. Consequently, the tribunals held that the obligation in Article 2(2)(c) of the treaty referred to an obligation of the host state as sovereign. The El Paso Tribunal heavily criticized SGS versus Philippines Tribunal by reiterating the argument that expansive construction of the umbrella clause rendered other substantive protections negatory and that instead of various substantive protections, the parties could have simply had the umbrella clause and the dispute resolution clause in the treaty. After making the distinction between actions of host state as merchants and that of a sovereign, the El Paso Tribunal observed, in view of the necessity to distinguish the state as a merchant, especially when it acts through instrumentalities from the state as sovereign, the tribunal considers that the umbrella clause in the Argentine-US BIT, which prescribes that each party shall observe any obligation it may have entered into with regard to its investments, can be interpreted in the light of Article 7(1), which clearly includes among the investment disputes under the treaty, all disputes resulting from a violation of a commitment given by the state as a sovereign state, either through an agreement, an authorization, or the BIT. It may be noted that Article 7(1) of the concerned BIT provided an investment dispute is a dispute between a party and a national or company of the other party arising out of or relating to A. an investment agreement between that party and such national or company. B. an investment authorization granted that by that party's foreign investment authority. And C. an alleged breach of any right conferred and created by this treaty with respect to an investment. It may be noted that the tribunal in El Paso clarified, it is the tribunal's view that it will not be enough to assert that the dispute is of a contractual nature to disqualify it as a legal dispute. It is well known that ICSID tribunals have been dealing over the years with contractual as well as non-contractual disputes. So, the tribunal's view was that the umbrella clause did not cover those contractual claims. It may be noted that the tribunals in El Paso and Pan American consist of authorities on international arbitration, as can be seen from the table on screen. It also appears that the criticism leveled in Dalzer and Schuer that Article 31 of the Vienna Convention on the Law of Treaties should have been relied on does not carry a punch. Theoretically, a case could go either way depending on a principle of construction of an instrument. But here, the question was the scope of substantive obligations in a treaty which had the effect of affecting millions of people. Surely, the decision this way or that way should be based on legitimate grounds. Otherwise, the legitimacy of international investment law could be called into question. Anyway, this lecture saw three approaches to the construction of umbrella clauses. The broad construction, as was done in SGS versus Philippines, the narrow construction, for example, SGS versus Pakistan, and the middle ground, that the clause called umbrella clause covers only sovereign acts, for example, El Paso versus Argentina. It appears that recent tribunals favor the broad construction approach. See, for instance, Nissan versus India, the decision on jurisdiction dated 29th April 2019. Roe and Portman's recent article cited in the description to this video usually summarizes the current trends in the construction of the umbrella clause. Those interested can have a look at it. Bye-bye and stay safe.